I think before I get started, I just, I don't, you don't all have to stand again, but I think we have a fellow firefighter that passed away recently, and he's a volunteer firefighter for Milford, and Ron Savage. I know we've heard a lot about him on the news and that, and today they're putting him to rest, so maybe if we could just bow our heads and offer a minute of silence for him and his family. Thanks. Thank you, everybody, and thank you and welcome to the Wixom Community Center. Thank you, Rich Ziegler, for the generous introduction and your dedication to the city of Wixom. Also, thank you to Pastor Stille for your invocation, and welcome to you and your bride. Pastor Stille of Wixom's First Baptist Church has always offered his words of wisdom and hope and prayers for our city. He's been involved with the church and Wixom Christian School for 14 years, so he's very enthusiastically part of this community in many, many ways. Griffin, do you want to give the speech tonight? Or? Okay. Thank you also to City Manager Clarence Goodline for your service to our community, and thanks to you all for those fine introductions tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, it is with great honor that I present to you our 9th State of the City Address of the City of Wixom. I'm extremely proud and honored to be married to my wife, Linda, Wixom's First Lady, my lifelong partner and best friend for 37 years. And thank you, Linda, as I tell you every year and every day, for your unwavering support and confidence in me. I couldn't possibly do all this without your support. I'd like to introduce my son, Eric Hinckley, and his wonderful wife, Amy. Eric serves as a captain in the Air National Guard at Selfridge Air Force Base and also works for Trigicon here in the city of Wixom. Amy works as a homemaker and has her days busy and caring, as you can see, for our new grandson, Griffin. He's quite a handful. I'd also like to acknowledge my daughter, Michelle, and her new husband, Justin Billard. Michelle and Justin, they live in Boston, Massachusetts, and they weren't able to attend this evening, but I know they're here in spirit. Also joining me tonight is my sister, Nanette Kennedy. Nan's down here from Holt. Excuse me. But she considers this her second home and finally refers to it as Whoville. So I do appreciate my children's love and my family's support. What a privilege and an honor it is to serve the citizens and taxpayers of Wixom this past year and to do this work with all of you, my fellow council members. So if you'd all please rise and be recognized for your efforts and volunteer to Wixom. Deputy Mayor Ziegler, council members Pat Beagle, Nick Kennedy, Tom Resnick, Keenan Gottschall, and Robert Smiley. Thank you. I'd also like to thank the individuals who serve on our boards and commissions, and I know there's a lot of you here tonight, but would all those members of our commissions please rise and be recognized? Our Board of Review, our Cemetery, our Construction Board of Appeals, our DDA, our Election Commission, our Friends of the Library, our Historical Society, our Land Acquisition, our Library Board, our LDFA, our Parks and Rec, our Planning Commission, our Senior Commission, and our Tax Abatement Review Board and our Zoning Board. All of you, please rise and let's have a round of applause. Come on. These are the folks that help us every day in doing a lot of the planning of our city. I'd also like to acknowledge Commissioner Phil Weipert. He was here earlier, but Phil had to leave. He had another commitment this evening with one of the associations that he is actually the president of, so he had a meeting at 7 o'clock. But also here this evening, our representative from District 39, Clint Kesto. Clint was first elected to serve in 2012. Clint represents residents of Wixom, Commerce, West Bloomfield Township, and the village of Wolverine Lake. He serves as the chair of the Law and Justice Committee and is also a member of the Commerce and Trade, Tax Policy and Elections and Ethics Committee. I'd also like to recognize Senator Mike Kowal. I know, I think Mike's on his way, but his bride, Eileen, is here with us, his wife, and she's also very active in many places. She's the Oakland County Commissioner. Mike was first elected to the Michigan State Senate in 2010. Now in his second term, he serves as the Senate Majority Floor Leader. Mike is the Vice Chair of the Commerce Committee and Oversight Committee, and he serves as a member of the Government Operations Joint Committee and Administrative Rules and Regulatory Reform Committees. One of his 2016 accomplishments, you'll hear a little bit more about this a little later in my presentation, but his legislation updates Michigan's current laws regarding autonomous vehicle testing to allow real-world testing and operation to determine the technology needed to safely introduce these vehicles into the marketplace. The bill would also specify that as technology emerges, companies will be able to operate a driverless vehicle on roads so long as an operator is able to supervise and control the vehicle. Liability provisions would ensure people are protected when they are acting in good faith with the manufacturer's instructions when they service a vehicle, but not when they make unsafe and unauthorized modifications. The legislation would also establish standards that these vehicles must adhere to, and it would authorize the creation of the American Center for Mobility at the abandoned Willow Run facility. The repurposed 300-acre lot is expected to serve as a vital role in Michigan's research and development surrounding autonomous vehicles. The redevelopment is expected to be a boost for the economies and surrounding communities, and as I said, you'll hear a little bit about how that's going to affect us. So Mike's here now. There he is. Stand up, Mike. Now I'd like to introduce you one of America's great municipal teams, members of our city administration, our department heads and employees, our city manager Clarence Goodline, our director of public safety and police chief Charles John, our fire chief Jeff Roberts, our city clerk Kathy Buck, our finance director Marilyn Stamper, our economic and business development director Deb Barker, our DPW director Tim Sikma, our community services director Deanna McGee, our library director Andrea Dickinson, and Tracy McCann, our senior coordinator. And all of you, please stand up just so all of you can come up at one time. Come on. We have some partners that help us run the city on a day-to-day basis, so I'd like to recognize them as well. Matt Delaney from Suez Water. Where are you at? There he is. Thank you. Carmen Aventini, our planning and consultant from CIB Planning. Carol Rosati of Johnson Rosati Schultz and Joppa. She's our city attorney. There she is. Just voted, what was it, number one attorney? I think Oakland County for communities or something like that. So round of applause towards that. We got the best in the business. Let's see here, Nancy Fought. Where's Nancy at? Did she make it tonight? There she is, Nancy Fought from Hubble, Roth & Clark, our city engineers. Ken Pike from our building official of Safebuilt. Where's Ken at? There he is. And Beth Case, she's the president of BPI, our information systems. There she is right there. You know, we recognize here tonight all of our employees, not just the department heads, because all of our employees make up the dedication and contribute to our success. So we have a great crew, and we've also hired some new employees in 2016. One in particular, or several in particular, was Eric Pulaski. Where's Eric at? Is he here or is he out on patrol? Where are you at? Huh? He's out. Yeah, he's one of our new police officers. Aaron Brenneman, is Aaron with us? Is he out too? There he is, there's Aaron. He's a new police officer. Russell Pearson, our DPW mechanic, and Tracy McCann, our senior coordinator, are some of our new hirees. We also had some promotions, and I'll just read through these. Andy Allen to DPW Foreman, Deborah Barker, Economic and Business Development Director, Andrea Dickinson, the Library Director, obviously Charlie Yon as Public Safety Director, Amanda Sapala and Hannah Lesniak at the Library were also promoted to full-time status. So let's give them a round of applause as well. And we had some individuals retire from the city. Many of you might have remembered Dave Goddard. He was with the DPW for 26 years. James Watt, he was with our police department for 16 years. I don't know if Jim stopped by tonight, but I don't think he did. And Michael Kosick, the police department for 9 years. They all served our community well, and we recognize them for their dedicated efforts over many years. Last year, I told you we have the right person for the city manager position. The organization, our staff, and our partners were all excited about the decision to hire Clarence Goodline. We were all very invigorated by the hiring of this individual and the positive change in our organization. The team approach versus my way or the highway has been a welcome change. It saddens me to announce this evening that Clarence has decided to fully retire. Some of his accomplishments. He was appointed to this position after nearly 38 years of service to the city of Wixom, 5 years as its police chief and 10 years as its police chief and public safety director. Clarence has brought leadership and management experience that included the successful administration and direction of the Wixom I-96 multi-jurisdictional shooter investigation and task force in 2012, and a command of police personnel during the 1996 Ford Motor Company shootings. We all remember that one too. Clarence is a 1984 graduate of Madonna University's Bachelor of Science in Criminal Justice Program, a 1992 Psi Chi Honors graduate of the University of Detroit Mercy's Master of Arts in Clinical Psychologically Program, and a 2004 Phi Alpha Alpha Honors graduate of Oakland University's Master of Public Administration Program. He is a graduate of the FBI National Academy and Executive Leadership Programs at both the Southern Police Institute and Senior Management Institute for Police. He's a Michigan Limited Licensed Psychologist and Adjunct Professor of Counseling Psychology, Research Methods, and Statistics at Rochester College, where he has served as such for many years. Clarence has served as a committee member and secretary of the Lower Peninsula Law Enforcement Risk Control Advisory Committee of the Michigan Municipal Risk Management Association and as a member of the Board of Directors of the Michigan Association of Professional Psychologists. It's with great honor I ask Clarence to stand and accept our thanks for nearly 38 years of service to our community. My pleasure, or I guess it might be Deputy Mayor's pleasure. Where are you, Deputy Mayor? Where's Charlie at? Charlie, where are you? It's my pleasure to present Clarence with a Shinola watch from employees, council members, and Wixom partners. As a token of our thanks for your dedication and service to this community, thank you very much.
Honestly, don't know what to say except thank you very much. I'm humbled and honored by not only the gifts, you know, but by the tribute. But in addition to that, thank you. Let me say that you all deserve another thank you, and that is that I have to tell you that honestly, this has been the best place that I have ever worked, and I've worked at a number of different places. It's the best place that I ever worked, primarily because of the people here and the employees that I see every day. I would tell you that the employees and the people here have made me a better person, and that the experience here has caused me to grow and to more easily face challenges in my life. I would tell you that that all of the employees here own part of all of my successes, and that I will forever be honored to have known you all and to have worked with you. Thank you.
Sorry, I'm a little bit of an emotional guy, but Clarence is a good friend. All right, there you have it. We'll get back on schedule here. That's our team, and thank you all for your good work and dedication and your work in day in and day out providing excellent service to our community. You have truly continued to make our city world-class, all of our employees and our partners as well. So let me share with you some of our city's accomplishments for this last year, which we've had a very, very busy busy season, busy year. And I'll start off with a letter from Clarence, our city manager, to myself and the employees as to where the city is. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for helping to make the city of Wixom a wonderful place in which to live, raise families, and work. You've made it a special and unique locale that feels more like a hamlet than the city that it is. Wixom is not merely a collection, but it's neighborhoods. We are a community, and indeed a community working together. The state of our city is strong, and the state of our community is even stronger. The combined commitment of the community, the city's elected officials, and city staff continues to make Wixom the best place to live, raise families, and work. Tonight we come together to reflect on our progress and to look forward to what is coming in the future. During the past year, Wixom has remained a leader in the delivery of city services and the development of partnerships that promote and expand the quality of life that residents and businesses experience here. Through all of our efforts, the city's future remains secure and prosperous. Residents overwhelmingly have supported the city's special millage last November, which has strengthened the city and provided it with resources to enable it to remain a leader in the delivery of city services. It has also allowed the city to continue its commitment to public safety and will enable the city to repair roads and to replace capital assets. Last year, the city completed its process of restaffing vacant police positions and provided full staffing for patrol, detective, and records department positions for the first time in 5 years. We also completed a comprehensive analysis of local roads that the city will use to drive a process for the repair and restoration. Our pledge to continuing excellence and evidence is evidenced by our unremitting recognition by scholars, businessmen, and community leaders. Again, last year we were recognized by the University of Michigan Dearborn as a 5-star entrepreneurial city for the 9th time in 10 years. Another member of our police staff was selected to attend the FBI National Academy for 10 weeks of executive police leadership training and become the 4th member to be selected over the past 25 years. Our fire department was recognized for its leadership ability when our fire chief was selected to head the Southeastern Michigan Fire Chiefs Association. Some of our accomplishment with our senior center. To enhance our senior program and its offerings, the city hired a new senior coordinator and adjusted the programming to better fit the needs of the city's seniors. It identified program sponsors and was able to expand events without increasing the expense. Most importantly, the senior coordinator has successfully created a new and welcoming environment as well as a joyful atmosphere at the senior lounge, and this ambiance has resulted in greater satisfaction by those who visit our senior lounge and participate in its programs. We open the center on Fridays to our seniors, giving them yet another day to meet and enjoy each other's company. Some of our accomplishments in the police department. Let me assure you, all is secure here. I've said before, government exists to protect its people. The public service means just that, public service to the people you serve and especially protect. I assure you, we've got you covered through thoughtful law enforcement and quick response emergency services. Chief and Public Safety Director Charlie Yan, he was appointed to serve as Director of Public Safety and Chief of Police for the City of Wixom. He was also nominated and elected to serve on the Michigan Municipal Risk Management Authority Law Enforcement and Advisory Committee. He was appointed to serve on the FBI National Academy Associates and Michigan Chapter Curriculum Committee. He was also nominated and elected to serve as Sergeant of Arms for the Oakland County Association of Chiefs of Police and Executive Board. Lieutenant Ron Moore attended the graduated from the FBI National Academy in Quantico, Virginia. Lieutenant Moore spent 10 weeks in Quantico and is a proud graduate of the FBI National Academy session number 264. Ron's here with us tonight, and I think that's a big sacrifice on his part. Ron also completed ALICE training. Now, I think I have this right, this acronym, alert, lockdown, inform, counter, evacuate, and emergency boxes, emergency?
Just evacuate.
Okay. All right. Alice. So for some of you that don't know that, again, the training became, he became a certified instructor and provided the training to nearly half of our city employees and will continue to make this training available to city staff, schools, and businesses. So essentially, I think what this does is help train us in the event of different types of emergencies on what to do, who to call, where to go, and what not to do. So that's a great training exercise for all of us in our businesses, and if your business is interested in it, I'm sure you can contact Lieutenant Moore and he'd be happy to come out to your location. Sergeant Linda Fultz, she attended and graduated from Eastern Michigan University School of Police and Staff Command. Sergeant Michael DeRosiers, he graduated from the Northwestern University School of Police Staff and Command. Sergeant DeRosiers also completed the Michigan Police Executive Development Seminar. Sergeant Mark Bradley, he was selected to attend the 2017 Eastern Michigan University School of Police and Staff Command. So let me tell you, all this shows the commitment on behalf of our police to their continued education and our protection. So I think it deserves a round of applause. They also continued with the ever popular Lakes Area Citizens Police Academy. Citizens from Novi, Milford, South Lyon, Walled Lake, Wolverine Lake, and Wixom make up this class. If you're interested in it, obviously contact our police department. I think we just launched this series, right? Yesterday, right. The police department obtained its first portable radar speed sign, so watch out because you don't know what this looks like. We're able to hook it to a sign and it runs off solar, right? So you really don't even know it's there, but watch out for it. But it's a great tool for us. We put it at several locations throughout the city. Okay, Pastor Brad Stilley from the First Baptist Church of Wixom completed the police chaplain training and became police chaplain for the Wixom Police Department. Pastor Stilley meets with police and administrative regularly, does ride-alongs, which I don't get to do, I guess, with officers, and is available to assist the officers when requested, so we're happy that you do that. In our fire department, ironically, this is a pretty big number, but we responded to 1,360 calls for fire service with zero firefighter injuries, and I think that deserves a big hand, too. They had 20 hours of continuing medical educational training, 128 hours of firefighter hands-on training. Fire Marshal Bradley Geisler, he successfully completed 40 hours of training to become NFPA certified fire inspector. Chief Roberts completed the national certification as an incident safety officer. Chief Roberts was also elected as the president of the Southeastern Michigan Association of Fire Chiefs. He was also appointed the executive board of the Regional Alliance of Fire Training. and our emergency medical transport revenue this year. Not that that's a good thing, but we do get paid for it, generated a little over $26,000 in revenue. They also hosted their ever popular 37th annual Breakfast with Santa campaign. That's the longest running event here in the city. We had over 800 children, parents, and grandparents were seen and photographed with Santa and receiving age and gender specific gifts, and as well enjoying pancakes and juice and coffee. Future goals of the fire department as we go forward is to increase our paid on-call firefighter staffing through increased recruitment programs. I'm going to stop right there for a minute because I think many of you may or may not know that our firefighters are paid on call. And I might say this every year, but it's not like we see on TV Chicago Fire where they're all hanging around the fire barn and they got great meals cooked for them and all that sort of thing. These men and women, they are actually at work within the community and around the area, and they're paid on call when an emergency strikes. And as I think our baby boomers have aged, the millennials are the next paid on call firefighters, and we really need to look forward to them to step up and become firefighters for our community. So each and every one of you, if you know somebody that has an interest in helping the city, they do get paid, okay, obviously, but we could certainly use your help in recruiting these paid-on-call firefighters. They're going to enhance the station coverage hours and continue public-private relationship with Huron Valley Ambulance with the certification of continued medical education for public safety and the employees. Our Department of Public Works, each year the DPW performs numerous tasks, which include plowing, salting of roads, tree trimming, and removal of dead animals, pothole repair, street sign issues and updates, catch basin repair and maintenance, placement of road legends and striping road right-of-way, shoulder maintenance and repair, that's a mouthful. During the summer months, they also mow 72 acres of city property, and they oversee noxious weed ordinances that utilize and a fertilization and weed control program that maintain the road right-of-ways. In 2016, the road maintenance program allowed us to utilize LDFA money to develop plans to repair Beck Road between Pontiac Trail and West Road, Frank Street, Anthony Drive, West Tech Drive, and Wixom Tech Drive in 2017, and as we've said before, West Road east of Beck in early 2018. This plan will combine over $3 million of LDFA money with a grant that we secured for over $800,000 for the West Road project, which was a federal aid and committee grant. The Quiet Zone, for those of you that aren't familiar with that, was located on the railroad tracks at West Maple. The final step of this construction is to install a pedestrian rail system for safety purposes. This system will direct pedestrians and non-motorized vehicles to look in both directions prior to crossing the railroad tracks. With this walkway, the current vehicle delineators and the crossing arms in place, the railroad has said they will designate the crossing as a quiet zone that will no longer require the trains to sound their horns at the intersection. And as you know, this has been a long process, and we are looking forward to a quieter crossing, Griffin, once the railroad has completed their review of the crossing work. The DPW also contracted to have over 23 miles of pavement striped and 62 road legends installed in 2016. The DPW is also developing a plan that will monitor the pavement markings over time to help staff budget for pavement and replacement in the future. DPW and HRC utilize the pavement surface evaluation rating, the PACER. You'll see some of the maps that we have around here in the community center tonight. The information was collected in 2015 to update our road maintenance master plan and improve the road conditions over the next 10 years. If you'll notice the maps that are displayed around the room, note that the lower number you'll see on the PACER rating, the lower number is the worst condition of the road. So if you think about how many of you ever travel West Road east of Beck, right? Okay, that thing is like a zero. So if you look at that as being our worst road in the city, and you can kind of look at the map and see what else, some of the other roads, how they fare out. In a joint effort for community enhancement, the DPW staff and Leisure Co-op, they also installed 70 burning bushes and 30 arborvitaes along 12 Mile Road for the right-of-way. These plants will not only provide a visual barrier from the road, but it's also expected to reduce the dust and noise levels as it reaches the condominium complex. The DPW also assisted two Eagle Scout projects in 2016. One of these projects included the installation of a new well pump for the cemetery, and another one included landscaping at the Indian Wells subdivision. And they also, as we all know, continue to be the best at city snow removal and leaf removal. So let's give them a our construction and development services department, better known as the building department, they provide administration and enforcement of building, plumbing, electrical, and mechanical zoning codes as adopted by our city council. Permits are issued through this department for new construction and alterations to existing facilities, commercial, industrial, and residential, examining and checking at the same time the plans are in compliance with our zoning codes. This department continued to improve construction and development services in conjunction with our economic development team. The permit issuance in 2016 increased by 12% compared to 1 year before. During 2016, our building department worked closely with the commercial and the industrial sector, and we had a lot of large projects. One in particular, as we've talked about before, is ADEP Plastics. That work is in progress with the construction of ADEP Plastics, a brand new plant on Alpha Drive, so that's just north of the freeway by our water tower. This large facility of approximately 111,000 square feet is their fifth plant here in the city of Wixom, and with final touches of completing the full construction, they're ahead of schedule. And by the way, ADEPT has also signed a contract with the city, advertising on the Wixom City's water tower, and this branding privilege will generate $50,000 in annual fees over the next 10 years. Zimmerman Incorporated is in the construction of a 13,000 plus square foot light industrial. That building was completed as well. The Hampton Inn, as you drive down near the interstate, you'll notice that that construction of that hotel is still in progress. BGK Ryan LLC is a building that's about 100,000 square foot industrial, which will be the future home of the Tremec facilities, and I'll have more on that a little bit later. Aldi's food store is up and run, or the construction is up and going, approximately 19,000 square foot facility, which was started there on the Menards property in November. Fiberglass, they also started constructing a 6,000 square foot warehouse that was in addition to their 23,000 plus foot building. And then you might have noticed the multi-tenant retail store that was constructed at Wixom Road that included Sherwin-Williams and AT&T, and we still have a space available. Myers, if you've been in there, they completed its interior remodeling and pharmacy area renovation, including and adding a new prescription drive-through. There was also construction of a brand new 13,000 square foot light industrial building that will be home of Diffin Ulmer and Weiss Chiropractic, and that was completed on West Road. On the residential side of construction, we also saw an increase of approved and issued building permits relative to residential single family homes and condos in 2016. In the VCA, we had 21 residential single family homes were completed in 2016. And already in 2017, Robertson Homes has budgeted for 20 single family homes. Yeah. With 14 homes already built. Yeah, Jim. Right. And three are sold, or probably more. Absolutely. Yeah. Robertson has also budgeted for 18 townhouses, with eight currently under construction and six sold. And I think you dug two more holes for eight more just in the last couple days. So Robertson is doing a great job here for us. Give Jim a round. Cliffs North up on Loon Lake Road, that's a new subdivision. And there has been nine new homes under construction there. And those are beautiful homes. If you haven't been up that way, stop up there and take a look at those. I think this is important to all of us through our building department. The ISO Building Code Enforcement Evaluation Report was received. ISO is an independent statistical rating and advisory organization that serves the property casualty insurance industry. This was last conducted in 2011, and Wixom retained its level 3 rating. However, overall points of effectiveness increased by 2.09 points, mainly due to the staff quality and services provided, including public education. Now, for those of you who don't know, this helps your rating on your homeowner's insurance or your residential insurance. So if you haven't had that updated recently, this ISO will help you in some cases lower your homeowner's or your commercial residential insurances. So that helps us immensely. Working with the mayor and the city council, the construction and development department is now actively involved in a code enforcement program for the city, which has remained consistent during the last couple of years. From our city planner, Carmen Aventini, we initiated and attended they had some quarterly joint meetings with the city council and the DDA and the planning commission and the zoning board of appeals. Our staff has made significant progress in closing out old escrow accounts and anticipates this completion of this effort in 2017. The continued development of the VCA through the site plan reviews and coordination with the city council and consultants and staff continues along and is doing wonderfully, as I just described to you with Robertson. The Planning Commission also worked on updates to the master plan, our bylaws and zoning ordinance to reflect the numerous changes occurring throughout our community and expecting to adopt these changes in 2017. We also had some joint board and commission workshops where this initiative, which you may remember I launched a year ago or a year and a half ago, this allows the City Council and the Planning Commission, the Zoning Board, and the DDA and department heads to strategize as a group. Ideas are shared as they relate to city, the developers, contractors, builders, and residents. The initiatives are reviewed and along with best practices provide the service, better service to our community. The group also discusses the city's master plan as it relates to economic development and our residential growth. Most recently, we discussed becoming what is known as a certified redevelopment ready community. And here's some of the criteria for that. Certified communities have removed the barriers to development, including eliminating uncertainties surrounding project timelines. In other words, that's getting your development or your construction shovel ready in a shorter period of time, and the approvals by implementing and executing this RRC best practices. You have to have a master plan, you have to have a downtown plan, you have to have a corridor plan, a capital improvement plan, all of which the city has. You have to have public participation where you involve the public in coming down for open forums and participate in the strategies. You have proactive practices for involvement. You track that success and you share those outcomes along with the participation of the residents. Again, all this is part of our city and our boards and commissions working to ensure that we have a better future. Our library accomplishments during 2016. The library focused on the goals outlined in their 2016-2020 strategic plan, which is very, very significant. These achievements included the following: starting a 1,000 book before kindergarten program, sponsoring ACT and SAT practice exams, developing a mobile makerspace, and adding a mobile hotspot lending program. The library also embarked on numerous capital improvement projects in 2016 that included replacing the carpet, adding new seating, and replacing all of our public computers. The library continues to increase numbers of items borrowed, patron visits, and number of attendees for our library programs. Let's give our library a round of applause. All right, Parks and Rec, one of my favorite. The 2016 sponsorship program generated a little over $48,000 from our local businesses in sponsoring our city events, which is an increase of about $3,400 from 2015. The Michigan Airline Trailway acquisition has been finalized as of the 1st of February, so we're really excited about that. The MNRTF and MDOT have approved all the appropriate documents in the purchase of the little over 5.5 mile railway is at no cost to any of the communities, which are Wixom, Walled Lake, and Commerce. Each community is committed to funding the development of the trailway, which the continued application of grant funds. You notice I said each community is committed, because Walled Lake is talking about backing out, but we're not going to let them do that. Our tennis and basketball courts at Gilbert Willis Park and Gunner Metalla have been repaired and resurfaced at a cost of around $36,000. And will provide safe athletic courts for our residents. Our Gilbert Willis Park roadway and a Habitat parking lot been resurfaced. The wire house, you might know, is under a little bit of restoration. The project is underway, and repairs being done to the foundation include tuck pointing and structurally securing Wixom's historic house for future generations. And you might know that right in the start of that, right, Clarence, the whole thing just kind of caved in, right? Yeah, so we had to take a little bit of emergency measures for that as well, and we got that under control. Our Gibson House, the interior and exterior improvements have been completed to provide ADA accessibility to the house and the restrooms, the porch upgrades, and a new gazebo. The Gibson House is now being utilized also by the Historical Society as a museum. We also had our family fun nights, which were added to our concert nights with different activities for children prior to the summer concerts. Our community development block grant program, this is a city-funded, partially service public service agencies where we funded money to Haven, Hospitality House, and Common Ground to assist in their services to our community. And I believe that the Gibson House improvements were funded also through that through 2013, from 2013 to 2016 through that block grant program as well. Our city clerk's office. What an election year we had, huh? Holy smokes, if you were down here voting, you noticed that we had a lot of people. Well, over 70% of our registered voters actually voted in the November 2016 election. Yeah. Our clerk's office introduced a rotating absentee counting board for the August election for smoother flow in the precincts. They introduced tablets at the presidential election, allowing workers to confirm voters were in the correct line and there were no issues with their voting status prior to them even getting into the precinct. We introduced a second electronic poll book in the busiest precinct, which allowed twice as many voters to be processed at the same time. They also visited Western High School in September to register 18 students to vote prior to the November election, and they recruited 6 students to become election workers. They contacted every registered voter at age 60 plus. They didn't contact me, but I think they figured I was going to vote. Asking them if they wanted to be part of the absentee voter list. And comments from that and our voters were very positive and appreciative that we contacted those 60 plus folks. They also visited the Courtyard Manor up here on Pontiac Trail in September, and they registered 43 residents to vote prior to November election and signed them all up for absentee ballots. Ironically, we did over 1,300 passports that were processed in 2016. That generated a little over $32,000. The clerk's office generated actually $40,000 in total passport revenue for 2016, which includes the photo and the passport together. While they had 100% accuracy, we passed an audit by the U.S. Department and the State Department of State on our passport procedures. And both the clerk and the deputy clerk were recertified as passport agents. So I think these are a round of applause. Yeah. So we're still showing some signs of continued growth. In fact, Wixom added 38 new businesses in 2016. I'm not going to go through them all here, and they're all listed here, but you can see we have several industrial, commercial, a couple other ones here, coming soon, Kentucky Trailer, and I talked about the Uber folks coming here. But we're very excited about all the new construction taking place and hope we can continue drawing residents and businesses to our wonderful city. As I've said to you in the past, my goals are business development, investing with confidence, our community volunteerism, and our community sponsorship. I'd like to highlight some of our businesses. Uber will open an autonomous vehicle research center in Wixom by the end of this month. In September, Uber launched a fleet of about 20 automated Ford Fusions in Pittsburgh and later expanded it to about 100 vehicles, including some Volvo X90 plug-in hybrid SUVs. Uber and the Swedish automaker are investing $150 million each to develop the next stage of their autonomous car strategies. About 15 million Americans will use a ride-hailing service this year. You're going to hail a car with nobody driving it? I don't know about that one for me. A figure projected to grow by more than 20 million by 2020, according to the eMarketer.com, a research website that studies the sharing economy. I'd also like to highlight one of our different types of businesses that's not into manufacturing here in the city, but it is putting out great athletes. The Moscone family has invested in the local community since 1991 when they bought the property in Lyon Township and built Cattails Golf Club. That was followed in 1996 with another large investment here in Wixom, the site of the current Total Sports Wixom facility. Tony Moscone has run Cattails since it opened, and when he took over Total Sports in 2006, he brought over the same team concept he used at Cattails to help grow and guide that business through tumultuous golf turndown of the early 2000s. During Tony's first full year at Total Sports, the company purchased and took over the Soccer Zone lease in Novi and then proceeded to add 9 more locations for a total of 10. And most recently, if you haven't driven along West Road, they took the old, I called it the Jarvis B. Webb conveyor setup facility, but that's where that new facility is now along West Road in Wixom. This incredible growth and constant innovations and focus on customer needs are all driven by the dynamic management team at Total Sports. The team's relentless pursuit to support all Total Sports customers to become the best they can be is second to none. Total Sports today consists of 10 locations that range from Oakland University in Rochester to Rossford, Ohio, encompassing over 1 million square feet under management and hosting more than 2 million annual visitors. Even with this expansive growth, the cornerstone of Total Sports remains the original location, Total Sports Wixom. Tens of thousands of athletes have passed through the doors at Total Sports Wixom and all leave with cherished memories of games, training, traveling with family, and the excitement of going to Total Wixom. Today, Total Sports is reaching the next generation as athletes from years back are now parents and bringing their children to Total Wixom as a place to grow and mature in a friendly, enthusiastic, team-based facility. Over its nearly 20 years of existence, Total Sports Complex has been the leading indoor provider of athletic space for youth sports in Michigan and the Midwest. The mutual respect of admiration and via the city of Wixom and Total Sports are a clear example of the success that can be achieved in unison with private and public sector. With new opportunities on the horizon and a lockstep partnership between Total Sports and the city of Wixom, Total Sports will continue to grow and provide a positive influence on youth sports in the United States for many years to come. And with us tonight, Tony Moscone and his wife, Janine. Please stand. Ops Solutions. If you hadn't had a chance to go online and check these guys out, you might not see the whole deal online because it's pretty proprietary, isn't it? Somewhat. Yeah. But Eve and Paul Reisner are the owners of Ops Solution, and representing them here this evening is Brian Close, the Executive Director of Sales. Ops has created a light guide system technology. The light guide systems is a patented technology designed by Ops Solutions LLC primarily for manufacturing. Everyone in the company comes from a manufacturing background. As of August 2016, they employed 21 people. Mr. Reisner was the Vice President and Plant Manager at Detroit Diesel and worked at General Motors and Bosch before that. Based on his manufacturing experience, the goal with Light Guide is to eliminate old work instruction manuals. Light Guide systems will replace those outdated written instruction books and augmented reality project work instructions. The Light Guide system projects the work instructions right onto the parts. Paper goes away and the need to look at a computer goes away. So if you can imagine standing at your workstation and let's say you're assembling a transmission and there's the picture of the part and everything that goes to it. Is that kind of in a nutshell? And as, let's say there's 10 parts that have to be put together in the transmission, as you put part one there, then the new picture of part two comes in, then the new picture of part three comes in, and then once you have the 10 parts, it's finished, ready for inspection. So it's pretty unique and very, very high tech. This system is actually a job creation and job retention tool because it helps keep people from making mistakes and being replaced by robots or automation because of it. Light Guide Systems is now basically in every industry, including medical, which is rapidly growing part of their business. It's not just about saving time or money, it becomes about saving lives. Their largest customer is Chrysler. They've documented 80% improvement in quality and 40% improvement in productivity using light guide systems. Ops Solutions' customer base includes a lot of world-class manufacturing companies. Ops has two main products, the Light Guide Classic, which has up to 11 different projectors, or the Light Guide Pro, which is the system used in the partnership with Hewlett-Packard Company. Mr. Reisner has indicated an interest in conducting class tours for school groups and providing programming internships. Ops Solutions utilizes the full-time temporary employees from Kettering University. Ops Solutions has also done some things in cooperation with Novi Schools, such as Technology Days, and they'll also be putting a light guide system in the Belleville High School, and they're willing to do that here at Walled Lake Western. So joining us here tonight is Mr. Close, their sales manager. Close enough. Let's give him a round of applause. Another new company, Tremec, is a Mexico-based corporation with operations in Mexico and in Europe. The company is involved in the manufacture of automotive and commercial vehicle transmissions and related components. With their new investment in the European business, Tremec has gained Metatronic technology and is now moving into automated class-leading dual-clutch transmissions, which are emerging in performance and luxury cars as being the ultimate solution for automotive transmissions. Tremec has been quite successful in developing a global business in this sector and has had several projects that require going into production for North American OEMs with such transmissions as where to make those transmissions. Jeremy Holt with Tremec said they explored making them in Mexico, in Europe, and various places in the U.S. Tremec felt that the technical base and the availability of people with appropriate skills and the infrastructure supply base surrounding an area were critical for its success in being able to execute this program. These transmissions are not easy to produce, they're very high tech, and they require a very clean and precise environment and very skilled workers. After an extensive search, Tremec excluded the possibility of building in Mexico due to the availability of appropriate skills, even though the costs were probably better. Europe was not possible due to requirements for NAFTA content. The search honed in on the Midwest, and they already have an R&D operation in Plymouth. The location in Wixom was chosen because of the positive business climate in this area and because of the positive experience that he had in Wixom with a previous company. The site was chosen on the basis of an MEDC grant that cooperated with Oakland County and the City of Wixom. The facility is about 120,000 square feet. Tremec will ultimately plan to co-locate the current Plymouth facility here in Wixom as well. They plan to employ more than 130 people, with at least 50 employees being degreed professionals in the technical or commercial fields. Walled Lake Western High School has students enrolled in robotics and computer programming classes, as well as students interested in engineering careers. And Tremec has reached out to them with an intern program that may be able to reach out to those students and strengthen their program at the high school, and also possibly flow some of those candidates into their facility and be part of their organization. So I think Jeremy here with us tonight? Jeremy Holt, where's Jeremy? Did you make it? I guess not, but let's give him a round of applause anyway. So after all that, and you look at how many new businesses we have here in Wixom, I think it's important to also note that all these new businesses, which I'm not going to go through and name, but it's an estimated over 750 new employees. So that's more people coming into our community, more people hopefully to buy homes and live here and work here as well. So hats off to all of our organization and all of our new businesses. You might think, what's this do for us? I thought I'd touch on this real quick. You know, this is our new taxable value for 2017. I'm not quite as good as the folks from Oakland County, but I'm probably not as boring. But anyways, because I'm not an accountant, but no, kudos to all of our accountants, but I'm probably not quite not like that. Anyways, but looky here in our commercial, we're 197 million as far as our taxable value last year, And this year we're projecting 205. You can see the industrial was 71 million. We're projecting through the Board of Review 78 million. Our residential 270 million, and we're projecting 282 million. So all told, we're looking at a change in taxable value of a little over 5%. The commercial change will be almost 4%, the industrial change almost 10%, and the residential change a little over 4.5%. The reason why I did want to show you this slide is simply because our taxable values are finally coming up, and it's a sign that the economy is rebounding in our favor. And with that, we still remain out of 31 cities in Oakland County. We're still one of the 11th lowest in tax rates, so that helps us generate new businesses and residents to come in here when we're still at 14.2 compared to some of these others that are much higher. And I'm glad we're not Hazel Park. Okay, our participation in Main Street Oakland County is gaining strength and interest among our community with fresh eyes, ears, and ideas. Our DDA has added several new members. I'm really excited about that. They're meeting more frequently with a mission statement and a goal to improve our downtown area. The DDA is currently working on several new events for our community, and note that the DDA is not just about holding events. They're about building our downtown. But just to give you a taste of some of their events, I have the Forbidden Art, which I encourage you, if you haven't already gotten a ticket to attend this, look at it online, and it's going to be a great exhibit of some terrific art, March 19th through April 6th. May 6th is our Derby Day. We're going to be bringing back racing to the city of Wixom. Some of you might remember we used to do this on 4th of July in the park, so we'll be featuring a 5K and 10K race. There'll be music and food trucks and lots of fun that day as well. Some of you might have attended our Wixom Block Party last year. It rained a little bit, but this year, the Block Party, there'll be music, there'll be a cannoli eating contest. Regina, and he tells me that you're one of the best, so you better come out and enjoy it. We're going to have a meatball contest, a pet adoption, and a lot more. There is a table out in the lobby if you'd like to learn a little bit more about these events. So again, as I've said in the past, and I keep telling you, I'm like a broken record, my wife says, this is all part of staying the course and investing with confidence to assure our stakeholders that we are working to grow this downtown, and we are. I've been relentless the past several years on staying the course and investing with confidence in the importance of reinventing how we do our work in Wixom. This reinventing is a mindset from top management down and is paramount in moving our city forward. We've had to change how we actually conduct our way of doing business day to day. Deputy Mayor Ziegler indicated that a little bit in his opening. We're attracting new companies and keeping existing companies. It's no easy task. Daily, our staff is thinking of ways to better promote our city and its assets. Most recently, you may have noticed our increased involvement with social media. On our city's website, which is pretty new and up to date, we have new information regarding our economic development efforts and much, much more. We're constantly updating and improving our website, and our Facebook followers have doubled this year. So like us on Facebook, so we'll triple next year. One of my other key points, I think, tonight is education. And sometimes we skip over this, but I think if we're going to attract businesses and residents to our community, you have to have quality education in your community and the city in which you live. You may not think that education and schools play an important part of the economic development of our city, but they do. People not only move to Wixom because of our brick and mortar, they come here because of our schools. Walled Lake Consolidated Schools, Wixom Christian School, Catholic Central, St. Catharines, and Oakland Schools, the Technical Campus, Southwest, and Oakland, the Opportunity Academy. And most of our residents, believe it or not, aren't even aware of how fortunate we are to have this many choices for education. And furthermore, I've run into people of late that they're not even aware of our Wixom Christian Academy or even our St. Catherine Girls Academy over on 12 Mile, right? Napier? Napier, yeah. So that campus is a beautiful campus. If you've never had a chance to drive over there and take a look at that campus, they're currently accepting open enrollment, right? And we're very fortunate to have them along with our other schools in our community. And I'm really glad that Pastor Stille, which is part of Wixom Christian Academy, and also here with us tonight, help me again, I'm sorry. He lives here in Wixom, though.
Ed Turek,
thanks, Ed. Sorry. From the St. Catherine's Girls Academy. Let's give him a round of applause. In addition to what the government does, is what our citizens do. And I'm going to need Councilman Resnick and Charlie Yon to come up here and help me with this one, too, please. As I said, in addition to what government does is what our citizens do, and the remarkable level of volunteerism that exists in our community inspires me every day. Many of you know we as a community have a long history of volunteering. All our community partners will benefit as a shared destiny and forged through volunteerism as a community service. Last year, we launched the Wixom Making a Difference Outstanding Community Service Award. The award honors persons who make significant contributions to our community through their time, actions, talents, and dedication. And the honoree selected serves as a role model for compassion, service, and striving to make the world a better place. This person has a passion for helping others in their community. I'm proud to announce this year's honoree is my friend Eddie Osmond.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you for all of you. Thank you.
Let me tell you why Eddie's up here, what this guy does for us, okay? He serves on our Local Development Finance Authority and our Tax Abatement Review Board. He's been instrumental in organizing fundraisers in our city, particularly when it involves our police and fire community. He is an inspiration to all of us in giving of his time and dedication to our city. Some of the events he's sponsored in Wixom include, in 2012, you may remember, the West Bloomfield Police Sergeant, Patrick O'Rourke, and he raised $14,000 for his family. In 2015, you may remember the Lansing firefighter, Dennis Rodman, who was, got hit by another vehicle, right?
Yes.
Yeah, he was hit by another vehicle, and Eddie raised $7,000 for his family. More recently, in 2016, the Wayne State University Police Sergeant, Colin Rose, and donating $10,000 and another fundraiser. The Wixom Fire Department open house, many donations of pop, water, and energy drinks. Our team golf outing contributes to that. And again, just please help me in thanking Eddie for being a great person. Wixom continues its tradition of hosting terrific events for all ages. I'd be remiss if I didn't touch on the sponsorships and assistance we receive here in the city for many of our local businesses and for several of our events. Many of our events are cost-deferred due to partnerships with our community businesses. These events, along with attracting regional attention, bring the community together and create a bond between the business community, residents, and those of us who are committed to nurturing Wixom's continued success and sustainability. I'm so proud of the way our community comes together through special events, and thanks to all who have contributed to make our events very special. I'd like to thank the following businesses and families for their contribution in our special events. So you can see there's a list of them here on the left side for our special events, which are, you can see in there, Adept Plastics and DTE Energy, NLB, Oak Creek, Total Sports, Two Men in a Truck, our own Wixom DDA. And also on the right, you'll see our concert sponsorships. Again, Adept Plastics, Drafting Table, General RV, Hubble, Roth, and Clark. So all these folks contribute and defer some of the cost of having these concerts and venues. So let's give them a big thank you. Are you getting hungry or thirsty yet? I'm getting to the end. Okay. We've been busy this year. Here's some of our recent cost-cutting and revenue-generating initiatives. We've continued to protect our core services through cost savings, efficiencies, and continued regional collaboration. We've partnered with Oakland County and the Michigan Economic Development Corps on business retention and attraction. We reduced our debt millage by 0.044 from 2015 to 2016. And this was due to a decrease to the water debt millage because we only collect what we need to make on the bond payments. The city continues to be recognized by Moody's Investor Service with a AA bond rating. This is the second highest rating in this scale a community can receive, and it's the rating reflects the city's healthy financial position, which is expected to strengthen, supported by a supplementary operating levy approved by the voters in November of 2016. The rating is also supported by the city's moderately sized suburban tax base, which is continuing to show signs of rebounding after significant valuation losses, which is why I wanted to show you those two, as I said, boring documents, but they are important to our increase in tax evaluation. As I stated earlier, we're continuing to plan and spend your money efficiently. I think this certainly deserves a round of applause to our council, our partners, and our staff. Good job, everybody. The multi-year budgeting, it still remains an important tool in the restructuring of our financial success, and this plan, along with continued budgeting sessions, offers valuable long-range planning and sustainability while utilizing our core assets to maintain a safe future for the residents of Wixom. We have balanced our budget, we've improved our staff, we've stimulated economic growth and added new businesses and lowered our debt, along with a slight decrease in our millage rate. We have also seen a slight increase in property values and shared revenue. The great news is, yes, we have accomplished these and many other reductions and increases in revenue. However, what many don't understand is that all that savings and reductions did not take into consideration the fact that cost of doing business, it continues to rise. We asked for a renewal of up to 3.5 mils for municipal operations in 2016, and the citizens responded a strong yes. Thank you. Working from a 5-year long-range budget plan, we determined that this would be required as a maximum to bring us back to improve sustainability. This would include police, fire, public works, along with our parks and rec. We're looking in the face of some major repairs here in the city, major roads, several million dollars, our wastewater treatment plant, $10 million, city office parking lot, $1 million. All these major repairs need attention over the next 4 years and beyond. As I told you last year, the DPW conducted an inspection on the city's roadways using the pavement surface evaluation rating PACER, which again you'll see up here on the study, and I've also included maps that show you some of these ratings. Okay, the DPW and HRC will work to update the road maintenance master plan and improve these conditions over the next 10 years. As I said earlier, we secured a grant of over $800,000 from the county for the rebuilding of West Road heading east on Beck Road and the over that railroad crossing. I'd also like to share with you that several of us, Deputy Mayor Ziegler, City Manager Goodline, and myself, along with some businesses, business owners from Wixom, we've been seeking funding and possible grants to widen Beck Road from I-96 to Pontiac Trail. This project would include a bridge over the railroad track. And believe it or not, this type of project will have an estimated cost of $70 million. Yeah. So we've been in contact with individuals at the federal level and at the state level and at the county level and along this corridor, a lot of the businesses who are very much in support of widening that road. And we hope that with some assistance from the federal government that we can secure funding and someday in the near future make this a reality. As you can see, infrastructure repair is high on our list of concern. No yawning. Our roads and other equipment are aging and will need to invest if we are to continue living and working in Wixom with the services we have come to expect. Last year, I explained to you what sustainability meant to me. It is the development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. The future of this community depends on us. We invest in our homes, our retirement, and we must invest in our city. We need to be givers, not takers. We have one of the best groups of employees and associates an organization could assemble. I've been mayor for 10 years and on city council for 6 years prior to that, and I've worked with three different city managers in that time frame. And we are now faced with the challenge of finding the right individual to be our next CEO. I'm confident our wage and salary committee will find the right person. We will not lose our focus on continually seeking cost-cutting measures and combining departments and staff where it makes economic sense. In addition to our efforts to combine many cost-saving steps and reductions already in place and working quite well. We'll continue to work from a 5-year plan to sustainability and staying the course and investing with confidence. So before I close, I would once again like to thank, there you go, they want me to close, there you go. Before I close, I'd like to once again thank Clarence Goodline for his dedication and service to this community and its staff. Clarence is good there. I'd like to thank the staff of the students of Walled Lake Schools for their TV studio and their TV studio for their contribution and volunteering to record this event tonight. They did a good job. Which, by the way, if you didn't get enough of this tonight and you want to see it again, it'll be on Walled Lake TV in about 4 or 5 days. So you can watch that maybe instead of some of the news, right? Let's see. Where am I? Yeah, they did a great job, Walled Lake. Thanks. I closed my report in 2016 by telling you how we in municipal government were experiencing what many had been experiencing in private sector. Restructuring, resizing, and right-sizing. We have accomplished this with the dedication of our staff and this council. The council has made tough decisions that have kept our community sound while providing and sustaining our services. We have several tough decisions ahead of us in finding a new city manager, trying to establish funding, along with seeking grants for road and other infrastructure repairs. We have done what any smart organization would do, review your strengths and weaknesses, and streamline your staff and equipment. As I said last year, we must address our infrastructure, roads, water, and sewer, while maintaining other assets, and we still have a responsibility to our taxpayers, and that's to deliver sound services. The renewal of our up to 3.5 mills for police, fire, DPW, and parks and recreation has given us the ability to continue and work towards a better community. And I'd like to thank the voters that supported this request, as it will provide big league opportunities for the city. We remain positive. We continue to strengthen our investment. The voters showed us that they are confident that as a result, Wixom indeed has a continued bright future. We can't afford to slow. We must finish what we've started. Leadership and management, along with taxpayers, must communicate and respect and work together. Together, we will all move Wixom forward. So as always, it is an extreme privilege and honor to serve as your mayor. I am certain and determined that staying the course and investing in our community will sustain our community for several years to come. Thank you so much for honoring the council and me tonight through your attendance here this evening. And please join us in the room right behind us for some terrific appetizers and refreshments prepared by Valari and donated by the Osmond family and the Hinckley family. And God bless you all. God bless our city. God bless our troops. And again, thank you for coming tonight. Thank you.